atmosphere that NEB is an ultraviolet cutoff. So that is nice because the series is ultimately regulated by this cutoff. And nuclear physics is very nice to us. Nuclear forces are much nicer than QCD forces. If you do QCD at finite chemical potential, and Thomas Schaefer can tell you lots about this, you run into big problems because of the fermion sign problem. I mean, if you want to formulate fermions at finite density, you want to do Monte Carlo, there's a problem with the sign. You don't have a definite sign, and then, of course, Monte Carlo algorithms run into problems. And this essentially limits lattice QCD for finite density. Nuclear forces are much nicer. Nuclear forces have this approximate weakness to force symmetry. This was pointed out by Eugene Wigner in the mid-50s. He pointed out that under combined spin isospin rotation, SU2 is SU4, nuclear forces are approximately symmetric. And this was pointed out also by, again, Dean Lee and Thomas Schaefer and Junwei Chen. 2004, if you go an exact limit of SU4 symmetry, you can show that the sign problem in this formulation of nuclear lattice simulation is absent, and then you have a bit of symmetry breaking due to the non-exactness of the symmetry and adding further nucleons apart from spin isospin saturated nuclei. Otherwise, the Monte Carlo methods are similar to what I'm using in lattice QCD transfer matrix and hybrid Monte Carlo. So that is essential setup, and I'm not going into the details. One important thing is in this method, you by construction generate all possible configurations. So this is something which, for example, in shell models, you have a problem in nuclear and other many-body approaches. So let's think of four nucleons. Here the lattice is just two-dimensional because of hard to draw more-dimensional lattices. So you can have four nucleons on different sides. You can have a doublet and two singlets. You can have two doublets, a triplet and a singlet. You can have up to four nucleons of one lattice size because you can have two portals, two nodules, spin up, spin down. This is allowed by Fermi exclusion principle. More are not possible, of course. And that means in this kind of formulation, all possible configurations are sampled. Of course, they have different weights depending on the relative energy, but there's not a configuration which is precluded by the function, by the ansatz itself. For example, in a shell model, you have very big problems to describe such a configuration, because in harmonic oscillator, this is not the configuration which naturally emerges. So clustering, which is a very important phenomenon in nuclear physics, emerges naturally. And ab initio, now I define finally ab initio, really means that you use the two and three nucleon potential as an input, so the parameters are fixed in two and three nucleon systems, and then you just solve this A-body potential exactly without any approximation using lattice simulations, and the grand challenge, of course, is spectral carbon thermals, in particular the Hoyle state. So that's what you want to do. And you need one more ingredient, and one ingredient is either a huge amount of very active graduate students who do this. This might not be efficient and very costly, and also graduate students might at some point lynch you. So the better graduate student for that is some machine like this, a highly parallel supercomputer, which we had in Munich with UGNP for some time, called Eugene, and now we have UGNQ, which is called Eugene. Now this machine in Munich has six petaflops, which means it has six times 1 with 15 zeros floating point operations per second. And of course, these things are very good for massively parallel problems like ours. Ours is very easy to program on such a architecture, and this is where such supercomputers come in very handy. So now we finally want to address the spectrum of carbon 12 in the Hoyle set. We have been written two physics letters on that. And there was a nice viewpoint by Morten Hodge-Jensen on these calculations. So before I show results on carbon 12, of course, first that we have to fix parameters. I mean, we work at next to next to leading order as a chiral expansion, which means we have nine data points, nine constants in the two nucleon sector, we have two constants in the three nucleon sector. So we use these we fix from two end scattering SNP waves in the neutron photopole moment to good precision, and then we take two data in the three nucleon system, like the triton binding energy and one neutron scattering length. And then everything else is a prediction, and here you see the first non-trivial prediction, which is the binding energy difference between helium-3 and the triton. So two neutrons, one proton, two neutrons. No, two protons, one neutron, one proton, two neutrons. So this is not large, it's just 0.76 MeV, and you still get this to good precision, this is shown here. As a function of the lattice volume, you get this with this uncertainty in the last digits. this is quite good. So you can really control small effects. It's not a big effect, and this you can already get with some precision. And then here's the other part, the other nuclear involved in the triple ion plus the cesium-4, it actually comes out, beryllium-8 comes out nicely, carbon-12 comes out nicely, and even oxygen-16 is somewhat overbound, I'll come back to that later. So these results are very promising, and important is I'll show this in more detail later, that the cesium-4 is very important to bring agreement between experiment and theory. And excited states are somewhat more difficult, so you have to develop some protection on the Kalman technique. Based on the large class of initial wave function, I'm not going into details here. You might ask if you want to know the details. Now you have to do a bit of work, so after like 8 million hours on your gene and your queen and a bit of human work, you could generate the spectrum shown. Here's the experiment, ground state. First excited state is 2+, you also get a 2+ with the proper energy. So these are the experimental energies, these are the mean energies, these are the uncertainties given by the speculation. Then there's a Hoyle state, this is the experimental energy, this is ours, so it's where it should sit. And then on top of the Hoyle state, there's a 2+ state, there's a splitting of about 2 mV, and you also get a splitting of about 2 mV. So this low-lying spectrum is exactly reproduced. Of course, the uncertainty can still be increased and proved by going to higher orders, I come to that later. But this is really the first step in the calculation of the Hoyle state. You see, you get this 0+ excitation exactly where it should be. And if you now analyze the wave function of this state, you see that the main contribution, not the full wave function, but the main contribution to the wave function is this bent arm triple alpha, so you have this elongated triangle of 3 alpha clusters. Whereas the ground state is more an isoscale triangle of 3 alphas. So you can say also something about the structure, how the state really looks. And then now you can look at this in more detail. And you find here the ground state, the first 2+, the Hoyle state, the second 2+. You see that in all cases, you get about 20% of the binding from the 3 nucleon force. You see here the contribution from the 2 nucleon force and the contribution from the 3 nucleon force. In all cases, it's about 20%. And without the 3 nucleon force, you would not be able to describe the empirical data, which is important. So you need a consistent 2 and 3 nucleon force. And this is what this KLDFP provides to you. And you get good agreement with experimental forces. The uncertainty here can be improved by going to higher orders. And also this second 2+ that is still under active investigation. This is the last paper here from the tunnel group that just came out a few months ago. And this was always difficult, and there have been some experiments which didn't see it, but now there's consensus that one sees it at this energy which is consistent with our prediction or post-prediction, I don't know how you call it. But now let me come to the most interesting part of the talk, namely the fate of carbon-based life as a function of the Borg masses. And this is shown here. Figure was provided by Dean. So here's our. So we want to address the question of how fine-tuned are the fundamental parameters of the standard model in this process. So here's our triple alpha process, which generates carbon-12, including the Hoyle state, and then a fourth alpha particle fuses with this carbon-12 to get oxygen-16. And the question is, now we know the protons and neutrons, all of these are made out of quarks, which have a certain parameter, namely the quark masses and the strong coupling constant, but the strong coupling constant by measuring transmutation is fixed from the nucleon mass, and that is, we cannot vary that. So we can vary the quark masses and electromagnetic repulsion between the protons. So the question, how much we can change these fundamental parameters which make up the nucleons, so the masses of the quarks and the fine structure constant, so that we still get to the nice blue planet like this Earth. There's enough carbon and oxygen, or to get some bad stuff like up here where no carbon oxygen based life has been generated. And this has been done recently in this combination of NLEFT. And let me first consider QCD only. So I fix electromagnetic strong coupling, electromagnetic phi structure constant at its value 1/137. And what essentially we want to know are all the relevant energy differences as a function of the pion mass. Why is that? Because we know since Galvan also ran off in 68 and then of course the same in QCD, that the pion mass gradually is given by the sum of the light quark masses. So you can, instead of talking about the quark mass dependence, you can just talk about the pion mass dependence. It's completely synonymous. So what we want to know essentially what is the difference of the Hoyle state, and this is the ground state energy of beryllium-8 and helium-4. As a function of this pion mass of the quark mass, and also, of course, at the same point, we have to look at what happens to the binding energy difference of beryllium-8 and twice helium-4, because that's the first step in the triple alpha reaction. And all this energy and energy difference, of course, depend on the parameters of QCD. So the leading order can write it in this very simple form. So there's an, and I show you a diagram how this looks like in a moment. There's an implicit dependence on the pion mass, on the quark mass. The nuclear mass enters, which of course depends on the pion mass. The pion nuclear coupling enters, which is given by the axial vector coupling divided by the pion decay constant. And then these two, I told you that short distance operators, which also depend on the pion mass. And this can be, the figure, this can be analyzed quite easily. So here is the leading order contribution to the nuclear force. So there's a one pion exchange. Of course, the pion propagator depends explicitly on the pion mass. So not a p-square minus a pi-square, so boson. Then here's this pion nuclear coupling. This vertex, of course, depends on the quark of pion mass. And the nuclear mass in this legs, of course, also depends on the pion mass. And here are these four nuclear couplings, which are called C0 and CI. The two of them, we denoted C, which depend on the pion mass. And this you can map. You can show this algebraically one-to-one on the pion mass depends on the inverse singleton triplet nuclear scattering length. It's just a little algebra, which I'm not going to show you here. And then if you do that, you treat these pion mass changes as small perturbation, you can do a Taylor expansion. And now this is the most complicated mass of the whole torque. You just have to do the chain rule. You get the explicit dependence on the pion in the one pion exchange potential. And then you get, of course, the changes of the nuclear mass. And the, of course, this parameter x1 is the nuclear mass with respect to the pion mass, pion nuclear coupling dependence, and then the two depends on these short distance operators. So essentially, you have these xi's, and then you have these derivatives. These derivatives can be calculated very nicely, I'll show you this in a moment, using our auxiliary field quantum Monte Carlo, and the xi's can be determined by taking lattice data on the nuclear mass as a function of the quark mass and the pion nuclear coupling. And these are more difficult to get. I'll show you how you do that in a moment. So first I show you the derivatives. You see here these various derivatives which appear of these energy differences. And here you see that you can, there are many diagrams, you don't have to see them all, it's done on purpose so that you don't go into details. Helium 4, all these derivatives here are shown. This is the ground state and the Hoyle state in carbon 12. And you can see that these are all the various derivatives. These are the Monte Carlo data for them. You can see that you can fit some logic with such kind of form, and then you can get the large continuum, which means the continuum limit in time. So that is good under, well under control. You can easily do that. And now you need these others, these x1 to x4. I told you x1 and x2 you can get from the quark mass expansion of the nuclear mass. There are lattice data on that. You get some number like this. X2 you get from the quark mass expansion of the nuclear axial vector constant, the pi decay constant, which are not so well known. So you see there's an uncertainty about the sign here, but this number is very small, so it doesn't really matter. And as I told you, the x3 and x4, by some algebra, you can map onto the quark mass dependence of the inverse singlet NN scattering length and the pi mass dependence of the inverse triplet NN scattering length. So having now set that up, we can now study these energy differences. And you can do that and you get something which looks like this. This is this delta H was the difference of the Hoyle state to the sum of beryllium 8 and helium 4. So you get some calculable number with the uncertainty times this first unknown. Another number times the second unknown, which is the inverse triplet scattering with respect to the pion mass. And then these are the constant terms, essentially x1 and x2. You get the same for beryllium, the binding energy of beryllium 8 minus twice helium 4. A similar expression goes to, for example, the difference between Boyle state and carbon 12 ground state.